So how do the Proverbs point us to Jesus? Well, one, that is a question that comes with quite a bit of controversy. There's so many people who I think run to the Proverbs and love the Proverbs simply because they think it's homespun wisdom. It's just wise principles on how to live life. And so they don't really see it connected to redemption. They don't really see it connected to the gospel. And they don't really, so it's more of, okay, now that you're saved, here's how you live. But is there a gospel-centered aspect to the book of Proverbs? I think that's a key question. If we believe what Paul says in 2 Timothy 3, not just that all scripture is given by inspiration of God, but when he says to Timothy, from childhood you've known the holy scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, then he's referencing the Old Testament. And that means Proverbs. That means Proverbs is designed not just to make you wise for sanctification, but also make you wise for justification, to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. And so how do we read Proverbs in that way? And so there's been two ways historically, and then there's a third way that's emerging. The two ways historically is, one is to identify wisdom, the personification of wisdom in Proverbs, as ultimately fulfilled in Jesus himself. And so Solomon continues to direct his son, and obviously by extension the people of Israel, in order to be wise, you have to have a relationship with wisdom. And that wisdom is this again, personified as a woman, because the Hebrew word for wisdom is a feminine noun. But this woman who was there at the creation, wisdom that was there at the creation, assisted God in creating the world, that gives, empowers kings to rule and these kinds of things. And Solomon's saying, son, marry wisdom, have a relationship with wisdom. And so ultimately we see in the New Testament authors tell us that Jesus is the one who pre-existed the creation. And Jesus is the one who, John 1 tells us, with God created the world. And so he is, as Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 1, the wisdom of God. And so he's the wisdom of God for us. And so to be wise, you have to have a relationship with Jesus. Wisdom in Proverbs ultimately points us to Jesus. The second way historically is to say, not only is Jesus wisdom, but he's the son. He's the son of David. He's the son of Solomon, who's growing in wisdom, in stature and favor with the Lord, as Luke 2 tells us. And so he is the son who is hearing the instruction of his father, ultimately of his divine heavenly father, and is actually walking in wisdom. A third way that folks have been kind of talking about for the last several years is to see that the structure of Proverbs and the actual content of what the authors of Proverbs are trying to do points us to Jesus. It's actually creating a prophetic expectation for a son who fulfills the book. There's a lot of stuff we could get into, but just to kind of put this succinctly, the first 9 chapters are these extended parental instruction from Solomon to his son, who's the crown prince, urging him to begin this relationship with wisdom and to avoid a relationship with woman folly. And so he's saying, avoid this woman who's going to cause you to die, and have this relationship with wisdom. And it culminates in chapter 9, where there's an invitation given by wisdom and there's an invitation given by folly. The invitation given by wisdom is about finding knowledge of the Holy One, okay? Knowledge of God, knowledge of the Holy One. And then at the end of the chapter is folly, who also offers, come to my house, eat my food, have a relationship with me. And the question is, who is the son going to choose? Historically, people have argued that the son chose wisdom. And then you see in chapters 10 through 29 how he begins to grow in wisdom and learn how to be, one, a faithful Israelite who's a good husband, good father, good neighbor, good friend. And then ultimately progresses in the later, in 25 and beyond, into how to rule in the court, how to have justice in the kingdom, all those different things. And so by the end of the book, he actually marries the noble wife. He's married wisdom, and he rules and reigns, you know, happily ever after. But what people are starting to look at now is, in chapter 9, he actually passes by wisdom's house. And so there's no good reason to think he actually chose wisdom. He actually chose folly. And so at the end of the book, in chapter 30, the son says, I have not attained knowledge of the Holy One. What was promised to him in Proverbs 9, he gets to Proverbs 30 and he says, I'm stupider than any other man. I've not obtained knowledge of the Holy One. And the only way for me to obtain real knowledge is for God and the Son of God to come down out of heaven. And then ultimately you get to chapter 31, where there's a mom, no dad in the picture, who gives birth to a son, a king, who is then married to wisdom and is going to reign forever. And it's actually called an oracle in Proverbs 30 and 31. This is a future expectation that, no, Solomon didn't live up to this, and Solomon's son didn't live up to this, But someday there's going to be, because God keeps his promise to David, there's going to be a son in the future who does this. And ultimately we see in Isaiah 11 that that expectation begins to build when they say, hey, listen, there's going to come a day, there's going to come a shoot out of Jesse. And guess what? He's going to be anointed by the spirit of wisdom, understanding, and the fear of the Lord. He's going to actually embody the book of Proverbs. And then ultimately we see that that shoot out of Jesse is Jesus of Nazareth. And so those are the kind of ways that you can read the book of Proverbs and see how they're all about Jesus. He is the ideal king, and he's the one that we've got to have a relationship to be wise. And then once we have that relationship, then we can be faithful citizens of the kingdom, and we can be good husbands, good neighbors, good fathers, good mothers, and live out the wisdom that God has called us to live out.